All right, we're in a series called One at a Time. And we're going to be in this, again, for 3.5 months. And here's what the whole idea of one at a time is. One at a time is really on sabbatical. When I read through the book of Acts a bunch of times and I read through the Gospels a bunch of times, one of the things that became crystal clear is as you read through the Gospels, you see the crowd, but you see Jesus's unique, unbelievable ability to, even in the midst of a ton of people, to focus in on the one. He would actually focus in on the one person. It's kind of like that Zoom feature when you're watching a film and maybe they got a bunch of people on the screen, but all of a sudden the camera zooms in on the one person and everything else in the background fades away. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at how Jesus looks at people, and what you need to understand is kind of twofold. Number one is that's the way that Jesus looks at you, your unique story, your struggles, your worth, your value, what's going on in your life. All right, Jesus can actually look and see, no, this is what's going on in Karen's life or Sue's life or Bruce's life. This is, and be able to do that all at the same time over here and over there. So number one, know that that's the way that God looks at you. But number two, in this year of one, we need all to also understand that's the way Jesus wants us as disciples and apprentices to emulate him and to look at people the same way. We want to look at people, not as projects, but as people made in the image of God, and to look at them one at a time. And so what we're doing is we're going to be going through and looking at those instances where Jesus does that. But let me start off. We're going to start off with some common people, some people that Jesus actually called at the very start of his ministry. And I want to start off with this question. Question being this: what comes to your mind when I say the word Christian? When I say the word Christian, what comes to your mind? As a matter of fact, I would venture to say that if I were to stop people on the street in downtown, whether it be Brevard or Hendersonville or Franklin or Waynesville or Asheville, if you were to stop people and ask them, are you a Christian? You would get a bunch of different answers. Some people would immediately say, yes, I definitely am. Some people would say, yes, well, what do you mean by that? Other people would say, yes, but I'm not like, and you fill in the blank. Other people would say, no, I'm definitely not a Christian. Other people would say, yes, I am a Christian. I became a Christian when I prayed this prayer, or I took this confirmation class, or maybe some people would even say, you know what, I've just always been a Christian. Here's what I want you to note that I mentioned a few weeks ago in another sermon, is the first followers of Jesus didn't actually call themselves Christians. That was not how they called themselves. That was actually a derogatory term, a pejorative term, done by the people who were in many ways were the enemies of the Jesus community. The word Christian is used 3 times in the New Testament. The word disciple is used 269 times. And as this week, as I thought about that, the word disciple is terrifyingly clear on what it means when a person surrenders to the lordship of Christ. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are crystal clear. And one of the things you notice when you read the Gospels, there are 2 recurring groups of people. On one hand, you have the disciples. The disciples, sometimes that's the 12, and sometimes that's any and all who have actually followed him. So one hand, you have the disciples, and then on the other hand, you have the crowd. What's extremely obvious is there is no third group. There is no third group of Christians who just agree with a lot of what Jesus says, but don't try to follow him in any meaningful way. There's a book I read a number of years ago by a guy named Kyle Idleman, and he was called Not a Fan. And in Not a Fan, Idleman makes the great distinction between a follower and a fan. And he says a follower is somebody who, by default, is actually being led by Jesus. They're going where Jesus leads them to go. They're taking steps of faith. But a fan is an enthusiastic admirer. Somebody, when the team is winning, is all about the team, but when the team is losing, they are not about the team anymore. And so he says a fan of Jesus is somebody that when everything is going awesome in their lives and Jesus is blessing their socks off, they're all about Jesus, but when the clouds come and the storm comes, they're like, you know what, I'm not on Team Jesus anymore. And the most frightening part about that is, not just does Idleman talk about it, Jesus talks about that. At the end of Matthew chapter 7, Jesus actually says this. He says, you've done this, and he names a bunch of pretty varsity level Christian things to do, but he says, depart from me, I never knew you. So what he can say is, Christians can say, here's my resume of what I actually do, but in the end, it's like, you know what? You were not a disciple. You were just a cultural Christian. And so the question on the floor today, a number of them, is, man, do I look like a disciple? Do other people look at me and they think that guy is a follower of Jesus? That person, that girl, she acts like she's following Jesus. She's not perfect, but there's definitely been a change in direction. So there's a bunch of questions that this text applies to. And what I want to try to do is show you from the text right at the start of Jesus's ministry is that there are several characteristics that actually are true of any disciple to some degree. And so if you're taking notes, there's like three little phrases. And the first phrase is really just one word. And just jot down the word. If you're a disciple, then you are beholding. You are beholding. Verse 35 says, the next day, again, John was standing with two of his disciples. And he looked at Jesus as he walked by and he said, behold, the Lamb of God. So number one, it's a disciple is beholding. You got to understand who, there's a bunch of Johns in the New Testament. The John they're talking about right here, initially, when they say John is John the Baptist. John the Baptist, we'll look at him in another week, but John the Baptist is that forerunner of Jesus. He is that man's man who goes out into the wilderness and he preaches a very, very strong message of repentance. And at this point in the ministry, John's platform is booming. He's being invited to all the conferences to speak. He's got a large Instagram profile. He's got a bunch of followers on Facebook. All this stuff is blowing up. His ministry is going huge. And yet when Jesus comes by, he makes it all about Jesus. That's a good lesson for us, by the way. It's a good lesson for you. Is when God is blessing you or your ministry or your church, you just got to realize, especially us as a church, God is blessing us in some unique ways. And we have to realize is it is not about the music, it's not about the kids' ministry, it's not about me. It's got to stay and it's got to be all about Jesus. And so what John does clearly is he says, I must decrease, he must increase. Less of me, more of Jesus. But he says, behold the Lamb of God. This is actually the second time. I don't know why they didn't get it the first time. But he says, behold the Lamb of God. And then he says it again the next day, behold the Lamb of God. If you go to church here very long, you realize this is a thread throughout the whole Bible. If you go back and you go back to, let's say, the Passover, that very famous story where God passed over the houses who would kill a lamb and put the blood over the doorpost, and then you kind of fast forward a little bit, and he instructed them in a similar way about their worship, about their temple worship. And their temple worship was basically, if you're a family, you take a lamb and you bring it up once a year and you bring it into the temple, and then the priest, he takes a knife and he kills the lamb, but at the same time, the father, typically as a representative of the family, puts his hand on the lamb. And when the lamb dies and the father puts his hand on the lamb and confesses the sin of the family, what's going on is the symbolism is the lamb is paying for the sins of my family. And so years go by and John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God. And so the word behold is what I want you to focus in on for a minute. The word behold is not just look at. Looking up the word, the synonyms for behold are pay attention to, focus on, and or consider the implications of this in your life. One of our young pastors last week at the staff devotional, our staff meeting, they did a staff devotional, and one of our young pastors did a great job, and he said, what you behold, you become. What you behold, what you focus on, what you behold, you become. What you look at, you begin to look like. What you revere, you resemble. And I thought, man, that's a gold nugget right there, because it's obvious. If you behold, pay attention to, find your security in something, that eventually becomes a driving force in your life. If you look at money as something you behold, that's where you find your identity, you will probably eventually become a pretty greedy and stingy person. If you behold approval and likes and clicks and all that stuff, you will probably be a very anxious person when you don't get the clicks and likes that you wanted. If you behold being a very powerful person, then you will probably be a pretty harsh boss. If you behold having a relationship, then you will go from girlfriend to girlfriend to girlfriend, or boyfriend to boyfriend to boyfriend. You don't want ever to be a time where you don't have somebody on your arm. If that's what you pay attention to, focus on, consider the implications. And what you're seeing here is a disciple. He says, I want you to behold, I want you to consider, I want you to pay attention to, I want your life to revolve around the Lamb of God. So right off the bat, a disciple is somebody whose life revolves around, you know what? That's what he did for me. That's the main thing in my life. Verse 37, the two disciples heard him say this and they followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, what are you seeking? And they said to him, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Now check this out. The first words that Jesus says in the Gospel of John is the phrase, what are you seeking? First thing Jesus says in the Gospel of John is, what is it that you are, what are you seeking? It's the idea, it's not just where you're staying, it's the idea of what's important to you. What purpose do you have? What are you looking for? What are you striving for? And then even the follow-up question is, what do I, Jesus, have to do with what you're striving for or what your purpose is? And that is a good question, by the way, to always ask ourselves. What is my purpose? What am I striving for? What am I going for? What is the purpose in life? Where do I want to be in 10 years? What kind of person is God shaping me into? That's a great question. And here's the reason you got to ask that of yourself all the time is because we live in a culture that doesn't want you to ask that question. We hate silence. I mean, that makes me nervous just being quiet for 5 seconds. But we hate the idea, because what happens is we are culturally appropriated to do everything, to not reflect on the soul, to go to TikTok, to Facebook, to check the scores, to look and see where our Amazon package is. And here's what you got to understand. I mean, this little deal right here is designed to disciple us. It's designed for us to behold this, because here's what happens. Every time you get a notification, every time you click, every time you check it, every time you even look at a score on ESPN, every time you look there, and these are good in and of themselves, but just every time you do that, the brain releases a little chemical called dopamine. It's the pleasure drug. It's what gives you pleasure. It's actually what is released in some degree when you're like having something pleasurable happening or being intimate with your spouse or something like that. But just clicking that, just getting a notification, just hearing that little ding, a little bit of dopamine kicks in. And so what it does is, it's not necessarily wrong. What it is, it's distracting. And so you live in a culture that wants to distract you, to not have you actually ask the question, what is it that I am seeking? And every time it hits, we're like Pavlov's dogs. Y'all remember that the way, it's like the oldest conditioning experiment when he noticed, Pavlov, this scientist, he noticed that when the dogs would have their meal given to them, they would start to drool. And they would give the meal to him and he'd start to drool. Meal to him and start to drool. And then they're like, well, let's check something out. Then they put a metronome or put a sound in front of the meal. So they would do the metronome and then feed him, metronome and then feed him. And it got to the point where the dogs would begin to salivate at the sound of the metronome and not just the meal. And so what happens now? If you get distracted, you're like, oh, I'm going to go for that. The dopamine kicks in, and what do? You and I never get to those difficult questions, the hard questions. What am I about anyway? What am I seeking? What is my purpose? Because Jesus is basically like, listen, what is it you're seeking? And Jesus, like he always does, or oftentimes, particularly in the Gospel of John, he's like up here on the top shelf, and everybody else is down here on the bottom shelf. So Jesus will like say stuff that means a lot more than just, hey, where are you guys staying? He means something a lot different than what everybody else is translating that for. For example, in John 6, he says, I am the bread of life. And what do the people think? They're like, hey, where's the Texas Roadhouse rolls? I mean, where are they? That's what they think. They think, we're going to the Roadhouse to get those little yeast rolls. And that's not what he's saying. He's like, listen, I'm the bread of life. I'm the bread of life. You go a little bit further in John chapter 3, he looks at a religious leader and he says, if you're going to go to the kingdom of heaven, you got to be born again. You got to go back inside your mom. You have to be born again. And Nicodemus is like, what? That is like, how am I going to go back into my mom? He's like, you don't understand. You don't understand. Remember how he tells the woman at the well? It's like, listen, I've got living water that if you drink of that water, you will never be thirsty again. And she's like, what? You don't have a bucket. You don't have anything. And what was he talking about? He wasn't talking about water. He's talking about the Spirit of God. And so when he asked him, he's like, what are you seeking? They're like not getting it at this point. So verse 39, he says this. He says to them, come and you will see. So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. It's like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the way they kept time back then. So here's it is. He starts where they are and he leads them to himself. And by the way, that's the way a lot of us came to follow Jesus. There was some need. All right, there was some need you had. Whether that was a marriage issue or a finance issue or a health issue or just that ache of, man, there's got to be more than to life than just getting up and going to work and working hard and being a good man and then coming home and watching ESPN and going to bed and doing the same thing. And it's like, man, those people have something I don't have. Whatever it is, that's the way Jesus deals with us. And ultimately, we talk about, well, I found Jesus. Really, Jesus found you. So the first thing, ask yourself the question right now as a disciple, am I beholding? Does my life revolve around paying attention to Jesus and what he did on the cross as the Lamb of God? That's number one. Number two, and this is not like 3 points. This is more of a progression than it is points. But number one is, am I beholding right now? Is it the number one? Is it what my life orbits around? Number two, it's not just beholding, but it's actually being with. Verse 40 says this. One of the two who heard John speak and follow Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Now let's be real. You can't follow Jesus exactly like they did 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago, the way you would follow your rabbi is physically, literally following in his footsteps. There's a saying that the dust of your rabbi is on you. That was like the highest compliment you could pay a disciple because they were following their disciple, their rabbi so close the dust was getting on them. But here we are 2,000 years later, and as a follower of Jesus, how do you follow him? Because he says, follow me over and over. The basic definition of a disciple is somebody who is going to follow Jesus. Jesus is leading me. So question on the floor. Right now, as you sit in church or as you watch online, as best you know, is Jesus leading you in pretty much every area? I'm not saying perfection. I'm saying, is Jesus leading you in every known area of your life? In every area of your life that Jesus has actually given you direction for, whether it be in the word or some wise counsel or both, are you actually following him right now in those areas that Jesus is leading you into? This never gets outgrown. You can be a disciple for 50 years and he'll be saying, I have another step of faith for you. I have another step of faith for you. I mean, he told me that to do this SBC, do I have another step for you? And so the question you got to ask is, am I following him right now? Is he leading me? Am I taking steps as a disciple? Now the question is, if that's the case, what is your next step in your discipleship journey? This is going to run the gamut to every single different person. What is the next step? What's one step God is calling you to take as an apprentice, as a disciple? Because by definition, if you're following Jesus, Jesus is going somewhere with you. The question then is, what is my next step of discipleship? Let me give you some examples. Like for a lot of folks, it is something super simple. Like if you're one of the many dozens who gave their life to Christ last weekend, that you surrender to the Lordship of Christ, that you said, you know what you did on the cross counted for me. I embrace you by faith. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. If that was you, your next step is to be baptized, all right? Baptism is an outward expression of something that Jesus did in you last weekend. What you do is your first step today, literally your step would be to go by one of those tables outside whatever campus you're on and say, you know what? I need to follow through in baptism. I need to follow through and be baptized. I don't want to be ashamed. I'm going to use the symbol that the New Testament gives us to show that I'm a follower of Jesus. Others of you, it might be just something as simple as like, I'm going to start to read the Bible more consistently. I'm going to read the Bible to my kids. I'm going to actually use this deal, and by the end of the summer, I will have read through Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Others of you be like, you know what? I need to get some community. We just moved here from California or Reno or Chicago or wherever, and every Sunday goes by, and you hear us push you into Connect Group, and now it's like, you know what? My step would literally be take a step into the lobby and say, tell me some Connect Groups that I can pick from, or would you have one call me? Some of you, it could be as simple as like a starting point. starting point. It's like, you know what? We moved here. We hadn't really found a church home. We think you guys are it. Then go to the starting point. All right, just go to the starting point. Sign up for the starting point. That is a step of your discipleship. Sometime you might have been going to this church for 10 years, and yet you've never actually plugged in and served. You kind of get carried along with the momentum. You love the way that people put out chairs. You love the way that people teach classes. You love the way that people take care of babies. You love the people take care of cars out there. You love the way people pray. You love all that stuff. But bottom line, at some point, you got to go from a consumer to a disciple. Sometimes it's, you're like, it's too busy. I'm too busy. I'm too busy. That's usually the number one thing. And maybe you are. Maybe you are. But just some statistics that might compel us a little bit. The average millennial is on their phone 4 hours a day. The person between 35 and 45, they watch 2 to 3 hours of television a day. Combined, that's almost a full-time job. What I'm saying is take some of that and put it toward what is a step I'm supposed to take. Now check this out, verse 41. Here's what he did. I mean, he's been a believer like a minute. He first found his own brother Simon, and he said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. By the way, Christ is not Jesus' last name. It's his title. It literally means anointed, which is synonymous with Messiah. And by the way, did you notice what happened here? He comes to faith in Christ, and his first instinct, his first act that we have privilege to see is to go tell his brother. Now, here's the part that's, I'm not sure of all the reasons, but it's statistically true. Statistically speaking, the most evangelistic disciples of Jesus are the newest disciples of Jesus. Do you know that? Statistically speaking, the newest believers, the people that have been the Christians for the shortest amount of time, are the people that are newest to the faith. They somehow have an instinctive understanding that I found Jesus, Jesus changed me. Here's kind of what the Bible says, as you see in this one. And hey, what he did for me, he can do for you. Now, part of that may be because you get where all your friends are believers, which that's the reason for the year of one. Realize, you know what, your best friends, your closest friends, yeah, the ones that you are like bonded with, yeah, those are to be believers. But your sphere of influence, your sphere of your friends is not to be just believers. You are not just to hop from one church meeting to the next potluck to the next fellowship. You are to be ambassadors. You are on mission with God. So if you've been a disciple for like 5 years, 10 years, you got to ask the question, am I following Jesus in the idea of sharing my faith? So here's what happens in verse 42. He brings him to Jesus. It's kind of awkward, by the way. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and he said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which actually means Peter. Now check it out. This is the first time Peter has met Jesus. They've known each other for like 10 seconds and Jesus changes his name. And there's really not a clear explanation why Jesus changes his name right here. I mean, that would be pretty awkward. It's like, you're no longer Simon, you're going to be Cephas. What? We just met, you're changing my name. But check out the symbolism. When you look at the text, Simon is his current name. Son of John, he uses all three. Son of John is his family name, his family identification. Maybe you can even say his past. Cephas, it means rock. It's a picture of what Jesus would make him into. And here's one of the things you got to understand. There's some things that happen immediately. Your identity when you become a disciple of Jesus changes immediately. Immediately. Your activity, though, changes progressively. Let me say it again. When you come to faith in Jesus, your identity changes. And I'll give you some of those identity points in a minute. Your identity changes immediately. The Bible talks about that as salvation. That is a point in time event. Everything changes, but the activity from your identity, you acting like who you really are, that takes some time. Theologians call that sanctification. Now, here's the reason I'm always harping on this. I always say a couple things all the time. When you come to Christ, you get a bunch of new stuff. You get a new heart, you get a new family, you get a new father, you get a new, all of that kind of stuff. What you don't get is you don't get a new mind. You don't get a new mind. That's what the Bible says. The way God changes you, a lot of the way God changes you is by the renewing of your mind. And so it shouldn't surprise us then that Jesus says you have an enemy, and he is what's called in John 8, the father of lies. It says he is the father of lies. That is his native tongue. So I thought it'd be interesting. I asked some of y'all on Facebook and asked some of our staff. I said, what are some names? What are some names that you got maybe called? And these are all adults as far as I know. I mean, all the staff obviously are. As far as I could check on Facebook, these were adults. So here we are. I said, as an adult, what are names that you actually were called earlier in your life that hurt and stuck with you and that kind of became part of your identity? Listen, I'm just going to read them as they are, so don't be offended. I'm just going to read them as they are. These are the names that are like, okay, this is the name that my enemy still brings up into my mind, even though I'm now like, whatever, 40 years old, and I got called this in middle school. So here's some of the names, just the way they wrote them. Ugly, dumb, brown noser, goody two-shoes, Uncle Tom, colored, dog, worthless, incompetent, will not amount to much, dummy, retarded, you're just like your mother, unwanted, you are a tax write-off, you are squid, you are bug eyes, you are chink eyes, over and over and over. I'm not going to read some of them. What I'm telling you is this: your enemy always has a name for you. And if you do not constantly, as you are with Jesus in things like the Bible and community, those names will stay with you. And every time God wants to do a new work in your life or in your family's life, that stuff will come flooding back to you. And what you have to do is be intent on understanding, you know what? When I came to Christ, when I became an apprentice, a disciple, the Bible says actually you're going to even get a new name in heaven. Revelation chapter 2, verse 17 says you will get a new name. But even right now, when you come to Christ, you get a new name, because what the Bible says about you is things like you are beloved, you are a son or daughter of God, you are gifted, you are valued, you're a co-heir with Christ, you are more than a conqueror, you are redeemed, you are reconciled, you are forgiven. And so those are the names that Jesus gives you that you have got to understand in Christ, that's who I am. You're like, I don't act like that. I don't act like a redeemed person. Let me say it again. Your identity, if your identity has changed, your activity, it's just a matter of time before it catches up if you are a disciple. Verse 43 says this: the next day Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip. The idea of intentionally looking for. So you see the whole pattern again. I get rescued, God puts me on the rescue team. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. So first thing is beholding. Okay, my life revolves around who Jesus is, right? That's my main thing that my life orbits around. Secondly, I gotta have some things in my life that I'm actually being with Jesus. I'm with Jesus in worship and Bible study and community and praying and those type of things, those grace gifts that God has given us. But then what happens is you go from beholding and then being with to actually becoming a different person. That is what God called me. Now I'm starting to look more and more like. So check out what goes on. Verse 45, Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote. By the way, this is a deal where I'm talking to you all the time. The whole Bible's about Jesus. Old Testament, New Testament. That's what he's saying here. It's all over the place. We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now again, it says Philip found Nathanael. I think one of the reasons that the Year of One is resonating with us is because you were built to make a difference in people's lives. And just like this brother just went out, he says, I'm gonna go. As soon as he got rescued, he went out, and he's like, I gotta find my friends. And so any Sunday that you're here, if you haven't already, go up to the wall and write the name of your one down as a reminder. Every time you come in this place or your campus, that's my one, that's my one. And heck, you know what? If your one actually comes to faith in Christ, which I know a lot of y'all already has, man, go circle that name if you want to and put another one down. That's allowed, all right? It's not cheating in church. You can actually do that. You're not going to flunk church if you write like a second name down. But the first thing he does, he's like, he goes out, I'm gonna go find a friend. I'm gonna go find a friend. And he goes out and he finds his friends and he says, listen, Jesus found me. I saw this in the Bible as a Jewish guy. You can too. Now check this out. This brother doesn't even know better, but he's a great example of how do you share your faith. He doesn't get sidetracked. So verse 46, he says, Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Now, Nazareth was kind of like a backwater, redneck part of Israel. And this is a pretty antagonistic statement. So he comes up there and basically is like, hey, will you go to church with me? And he's like, can anything good come out of, and you just named the redneck town. You named the small town. That's what Nazareth was. It was very, very snobby. And all Philip says is he doesn't argue with him. He doesn't take up for Nazareth. He doesn't say any stuff. All he does, he's like, hey, you know, come and see. Again, Philip's been a disciple for one day and he's already emulating his rabbi. Now, the question that I usually get most of the time is, all right, man, for my one, but I don't know how to go from NC State is in the Final Four and make the jump over to Jesus loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. I mean, how do you go from like A to Z that quick? And that's a legit deal because, you know, it's like, you know, you can Jesus juke people really quick and you're like, wait a minute, I just thought we were talking about NC's. What? So here's a little clue you can do at school. You can do it tomorrow. I mentioned it a couple times before. If you're like, I got to figure out how to do it. All you got to do, go into work tomorrow, go into school tomorrow. And because we live in the South, they're going to be obligated to respond. But all you got to do is ask, what did you do this weekend? What'd you do this weekend? They're going to tell you something. Man, we went to the waterfalls. We played golf. We had an amazing time. And listen, actually listen to what they say. And because we do live in the South, it is polite manners for them to then ask you what? What'd you do this weekend? That's when you just go, I tell you what, you know what's kind of cool? It's like, I didn't really grow up in church, but I've been going to this church. And you know what? We're actually looking in the Bible about how Jesus actually looks at the individual, not just the crowd. I mean, it's amazing that with all the stuff going on in the world, with all the problems in the world, that Jesus actually sees the individual. That's pretty cool. So that's kind of what we're learning. We'd love for you to go with me sometime. As a matter of fact, I go to the 9 o'clock service, I go to the 11 o'clock service, I go to the Hendersonville campus, or whatever it is. Why don't you come with me? We'll go get a donut, and then we'll go to church. That's what you got to do. Because here's what he's doing. They say, learning theorists, they say, here's the way that learning works. Number one, I do, and you watch. But think about anything you've learned. Think about if you were grew up and your dad was a good mechanic. What happened? He's like, I'm going to do this. You watch. You touch it right now, you're going to break the whole thing. So number one is I do and you watch. Number two is I do and you help. Hey, pass me the wrench. Pass me the wrench. And we're going to change the oil today. It's like the most basic thing we're going to do. So I'm going to do it. You're going to watch. I'm going to do. You're going to help. Third thing they say is you do it and I help. You do it. I'll help you. I'm not going to let you blow the house up, but I'm going to help. And then fourthly is you do it and I watch. That's how everybody learns. Now, here's what I want you to see. That is exactly the process that Jesus trained his apprentices in. At first, what did they do? They just followed him around and watched what he did. It's like, man, that's a good sermon he preached. Man, look at the way he prays. Man, look at the way he heals. Man, look at the way that he treats people. That's amazing. All they did is they were with him. He did it all and they watched. And then over time, they began to kind of help Jesus. Help him a little bit. Hey, we're going to pass out the bread baskets, all right? You guys take the bread and you guys distribute the bread. You all pick up the 12 basketfuls left over, all of that stuff. And then they begin to do a little bit of Jesus's work, a little bit at a time. They got a lot of feedback. Remember that? Remember the stories? He's like, he sends them out two by two and they kind of mess up the whole thing and they come back licking the wounds and like, it kind of daps them up a little bit. It's like, all right, a little bit right, a lot of wrong. Let's correct this. And then what does he do? He sends them out again. And then eventually he dies on a cross, goes in a tomb, ascends, resurrects, and ascends back into heaven. And the whole book of Acts is about how they learned from him and how God used them. And so you're a disciple here, and that's all that's going on in this story. That's all that's going on in your story. So here's how it ends. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him. Now, feels like a shock the way he responds. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit. And you're like, what? He was just making fun of my hometown. What are you talking about? But Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? Now check this out. How do you know me? How do you know me? Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Now, before you even look at the reaction, a little bit of background. There's a group called the Talmud that would actually have these Jewish teachers that would tell Jewish men how they were to act, how they were to put faith into practice. And one of the main ones was they encouraged Jewish young men to go find a large tree every day, read the scriptures, meditate on the scriptures, and pray to God. So again, this is not in the Bible. This is Bruce, not Bible right here. But when you see his reaction, there's every indication that this brother was sitting there under a tree reading the scripture. We do not know where in the scripture. Maybe he was praying and sharing some deep hurts and deep concerns back to God. Maybe something that was so personal or so shameful that he was like praying quietly. He wasn't even praying out loud, but there was something, as you're going to see, there was something going on underneath that tree that when Jesus says, you know what? I saw you under that tree. Because his reaction is not like, if I came up to you and I said, you know what? Hey, man, I saw you at Publix the other day. You would not have the reaction this brother's going to have. You're not. So something's going on because the very next verse, he says this. Nathanael answered him and said to him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Now check it out. What happened here, what happened with Nathanael, is another example of the way Jesus deals with people one at a time. So there he is, he's reading his Bible, he's praying, he's thinking about it, and he's praying something back to God, just like his people had taught him. All of a sudden, this guy comes up, and it's like, I heard your prayers, even though you were praying that silently. And he's like, listen, between the Bible study, between my friend, and between you telling me something that nobody else knows, you're the Son of God. And loving, what I want you to just understand is Jesus hears those prayers as well. He hears your prayers. He hears your prayers when you're like, I don't want anybody to know about this because I have a lot of shame over this. Or some burden you've got, like, I don't know why my prodigal's acting like this or why my marriage is slipping. I don't understand that. He invites you to pray over that, and he hears it. And here's the way the story ends. Jesus answered him and says, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. In other words, I'm going to use you. You're going to turn the world upside down with my power, my spirit inside you. You're going to turn everything upside down. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man, which, by the way, is probably a reference to Genesis 28 and Jacob's ladder and all that kind of stuff. So here's what could be cool. Again, not Bible. This is just step away for a second. How awesome would that have been if that's where he was reading? If he was reading in Genesis 28 and he's reading about this ladder and all of a sudden he's like, I heard you, I saw you, I know what you were reading. And he's like, oh my goodness. And the amazing part about it, that's what happens when you do Bible study. So what I wanted you to do is when you read the Bible, pray through the Bible. You're praying the Bible. You read the Bible, but when you pray over the Bible, that word that's 2,000 years old yet living and active, God uses that and makes it very contemporary for you. So again, just do what Nathanael did. That's what disciples do. They behold, my life revolves around you. They're with, but then they become something. And a lot of times what we try to do at our church is we try to match up the response song with somewhat of the theme or the thread of the message. Because what we understand is we do like some worship, and then we do some word, and then we do a little bit more worship. But that back part of that worship is our response to what God might have talked to us about through the word. And so for you, this song, by the way, this song is called Make Room. And the part of it is like, here is where I lay it down. Every burden, every crown. So here's the idea. Is there a burden that you have that you need to give over to God? Is there some crown? Crown is just the idea of some reward, some success, something that's come into your life that you also need to, you surrender the burdens, you surrender the blessings. Man, God gave me a company this week. Well, God, that's your company. God, I got a cancer call this week. You give that over to God. So that's just the first line. But the chorus says, I will make room. I will make room. I will make room for you. And maybe that's where you are. You need to make room. Maybe there's some things you just kind of, is it a, you're like, I'm a disciple, I know I'm a follower of Jesus. Bottom line, PB, if you really wanted to know the truth, I hadn't read the Bible since Easter. And last week, I read it, put it in the top of my car, put it in my console. I hadn't opened it up since then, but God's like, I want to speak to you. So maybe for you, it's like, I want to surrender the fact that I actually need to get in the Word. I need to do that. So the way we talk about it here is we come, sing, bring. So for some of you, take that burden, that blessing, come pray. Some of you go to the wall. You can go over there and say, here's my one. Then you can pray over them and you can go back to your seat. Some of you need to come up and say, God, there's some stuff, adjustments. I don't look much like a disciple right now. I don't look much like an apprentice. People around me, they don't even know I'm a believer. And so there's some adjustments that I need to make that you've made super clear to me. Then tell him that. The cool part about this song, by the way, is it's first person. Most of our songs are to God, not about God. This is one of them. So even as you're singing, realize that everybody at all the different locations are singing the same song. So think about it this way. You got everybody at seven different places singing the same song, but even more so, praying the same prayer. And so if we're singing the song with authenticity, what we're saying is, God, I want to make room for you. So whether you're coming up here to pray, whether you're singing that song, whatever it is you're doing, make that your prayer. God, I want to make room for you. And there's one part in here that's like, that talks about surrender. And here's what I will tell you by personal experience. It is a lot easier to sing about surrender than it is to actually surrender. It's a lot easier to sing this song about surrender than it is actually to surrender. Surrender means you take your hands off. Maybe there's an area, just like I was dealing with for a few months, that you need to surrender over and say, you know what, if that's what you want me to do, I will take at least one step of faith and leave the results to you. Might be a job calling, might be foster care, might be who knows what. So why don't you stand to your feet, and I'm going to pray, and then when I say amen, we will respond. So respond by praying, respond by going to a wall, respond by singing that, you know what, this is actually going to be true in my life. But Father, that's our prayer. Our prayer is over the next about 4 minutes. There would be an intensity to the way that we sing the song that is unusual, that is unique, that is intense, that we mean what we are singing, that we want you to kind of tear down the stuff we've gotten used to, and that you would put just a new faith, a new step in our journey with Jesus. God, we're grateful for what we got to see last weekend. We're grateful for the people that you wrote a story on their life, and we can't wait to hear those stories in the days ahead. But God, there's a lot of us that, you know, we didn't see that with our one, and we don't want to give up faith at all. We want to be persistent in prayer. We want to be like that widow in the story that, you know what, she kept on persisting and she kept on bringing her requests. We're going to be like that. We're going to keep praying and we're not going to give up hope. So God, my prayer is again for our church, the next 4 minutes, that would be what it really is, a response to discipleship. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.